हरि ओम। टुडे वी डील विथ द सेकंड मंत्र इन सेक्शन 2 ऑफ चैप्टर 3 ऑफ मुंडकोपनिषद। ये मंत्र रीड्स कामान या कामयते मन्यमाना स कामभिर् जायते तत्र तत्र पर्याप्त कामस्य कृतात्मनस्तु इहैव सर्वे प्रविलीयन्ति कामा। एंड दी वर्ड मीनिंग इज एज पर शंकर भाष्य, ही हु ब्रीड्स ऑन और लॉन्ग्स फॉर ऑब्जेक्ट्स ऑफ डिजायर इज बॉर्न हियर एंड देयर with such unfulfilled desires, but of him whose desires have been sublimated and who has clearly understood and realized the Atman, the desires end even here in this world. This is the word meaning. Or as usual, we get into the bit of detailed explanation within the framework of time. See, desire as a peculiar character the more you fulfill a desire the more it demands. Have you noticed? Hardly you fulfill a desire, 10 others come in line and tell you, please attend to me, please attend to me. It is never shut up. It is open-ended. Any desire fulfilled in any given situation, it will immediately ask you plus one. Wherever you are, I want to go two steps. Yes, you go two steps. There he will say plus one. It goes on. It goes on like that. No desire in this world has so far said enough permanently. Never. It is human nature. You have to live with it. You should understand the nature of desire, the character of desire. Then you have succeeded in your life. There is a beautiful shloka on this. Shloka is Malayalam, but words are Sanskrit. So what you have to do, I will read it twice. It read like this: Nasyo vashtishatam shati dashashatam laksham sahasradhipo laksheshat chidipalanam chidipati shakreshatam vanchati shakreshasurajatam surapadir ब्रह्मस्पदं वांछति ब्रह्म शैवपदं शिवो हरिपदं आशाविदं कोगदा। कन्फ्यूज्ड, नॉट अंडरस्टूड द मीनिंग बिकॉज इट इज संस्कृत। आशाविदं कोगदा, दिस इज द वे ऑफ आशा। आशा मीन डिजायर, नॉट दैट यू हैव अंडरस्टूड नाउ। आशाविदं कोगदा, गदा इज द वे, सो दिस इज द वे ऑफ द आशा। Where is Sanskrit coming in? Nisso vashtishatam, a man who has no money with him. Nisso, no money with him. What he wants just 100 rupees. Just if I get 100 rupees, I am so happy. Nasyo vashtishatam, okay, tadastu, here is your 100 rupees. Shati, if he becomes that. Dashashatam, he wants 1,000 rupees. You see, nowadays 100 rupees is nothing. It will melt away in the pocket. I just want 1000 rupees. Dashashatam. Okay, then if you become 1000 rupees you get, you become a 1000 adhipati. Sahasradhipa. You are owner of 1000 rupees. Sahasradhipa. Laksham sahasradhipo. He wants to be a lakhier. Look at the answer. It is there. Nasuo vashtishatam. Shati dashashatam. Shati means 10 times. Shati dashashatam. Laksham sahasradhipo. A 1000 rupees man wants 1 lakh. Lakshesha. All right. He gets 1 lakh. Then when he gets 1 lakh, no interest for money, no desire for money. It takes a different route. The desire takes a different route. What does he want? Kshidipalanam. He wants to rule the world now. He wants to be a politician. Enter into politics. He wants to be a councillor, then an MLA, yeah, chairman of the municipal council. Then he wants the MLA, then he wants an MP, then he wants to become a PM, then he wants to become a president. Lakshesha kshidipalanam. Okay. Kshidipati. If you become a kshidipati, a king, okay, and territory is given to you, you rule this. No, he won't stop. Shakreshadam vanchati. He wants to be an emperor. Vanchati means desire. He desires to be Shakreshadam vanchati. He wants to be an emperor, king of kings, the Tsar. Where did he start? With no money in his pocket. And what did he want first? Just 100 rupees. Now what does he want? He wants to be an emperor. See how it goes. And he doesn't stop. Okay, Tadastu, you are an emperor. Shakresha Surarajatam. He wants to be Devendra. What is his worldly life and worldly kingdom? I want to go to heaven and be a king there. Whatever you want, I'll do. Yaga, yatnya, you tell me. But I want to go there. Shakresha Surarajatam. Okay. In course of time, you become a Surabadi. Surabadir. Then what he wants? Brahmaspadam vanchati. He wants to be the Brahma, the creator, the powerful man. He creates the whole world. Not Brahman, Brahma. Saraswati's husband. That Brahma. Not Brahman, not the Brahman what we are discussing in the Upanishads. Don't mistake this and that. So being an Indra is not enough for him. He wants to be Brahmaspadam vanchati. Okay, install him as a Brahma. Because there will be a time when this Brahma dies. After so many years, not human years is incalculable, Brahma also has to die one day. So after his death, you will be incarnated as Brahma. Can he keep quiet? No. He wants a transfer. Brahma Shaiva Padam. He feels Shiva is better. Kailas, quiet place, good for meditation. Very nice. Nobody will come and disturb you. You can keep on distracting the world that Brahma has created. I take pleasure in creation. I am a narcissist. I want everything to be created. I say sadistic pleasure. Very good. No, I want to destroy things. I want to transfer. Brahma Shaiva Padam. Okay. Be there for some time. Is he happy? No. Shivo Hari Padam. He wants to be Hari. He wants to be Vishnu. Asha Vidhanko Gada. This is the way the Asha is going. Is this not what exactly our ancient vernacular, poor Brahmin Pundanam said, sitting in that quiet village? Did he not say the same thing in his Jnanapana? So this is the nature of the desire with which you are toying with. You are playing with this. A fellow who has got this character, be careful. Now, having known his nature, let us see the genesis and exodus of these desires. Genesis and exodus, meaning from where they came and how they go. Where does this fellow come from? Where does desire come from? Please think. Desires stem from our thoughts. Is it not? The desire to go for a movie did not suddenly shoot up from nowhere in your mind. The desire manifested in your mind as a result of your thought entertained in your intellect long ago, and so far lying in that intellect as static, and now this Sunday afternoon it has become kinetic. That thought to go for a movie jumped up in the intellect of the individual, expressed through your mind, has become your desire. Yes or no? A mere thought in the intellect is not strong enough to push your sense organs of perception and sense organs of action. A mere thought entertained in the intellect cannot make your legs move towards a cinema hall. The legs must get its marching orders from the mind. Therefore, the intellect pushes the thought in the fraction of a second. All this happens in the fraction of a second. It pushes the thought into the mind, which turns out to be a desire. And if that desire has sufficient horsepower, meaning strength, the mind will order the sense organs of action to get up and walk towards the theater. If it is not strong enough, the mind may either dismiss it at the threshold level, no, don't go, movie not required, or keep it pending to gather strength. And it becomes irresistible desire, then you go for a movie. So the desire comes from the thought arised in the intellect. Now, how did the intellect entertain this thought of going for a movie? Think. If the intellect had not known what a movie is, assume for a moment that he never knew what a movie is, it would not have entertained such an idea at all, isn't it? If you don't know about a thing, how can you entertain an idea about that thing? Let me ask you, can your intellect right now, think about Gaga Bugayan? Can your intellect right now think about Gaga Bugayan? It cannot, because it does not know what Gaga Bugayan is all about. In other words, it has no experience of Gaga Bugayan. Therefore, it cannot think about Gaga Bugayan. Whereas, he had an earlier experience of a movie, and hence a thought to repeat that enjoyment occurred in the intellect. Is it not true? This experience or the urge is technically called in Vedanta study, in its, what do you call that? In its jargon, as vasanas. Therefore, the thoughts come from the vasanas. What are vasanas? The vasanas are deposited in your bosom because of what? Because of ignorance or avidya. Ignorance of the fact that you are full and perfect. When you are full and perfect, there can be no desire for you. This ignorance can vanish only on the arrival of the knowledge of who you are. So the primordial reason for desire is our avidya, ignorance. Now that was the genesis of desire. You are going back from desire to thought, thought to vasanas, and vasana to ignorance. Now where did the ignorance come from? That we don't know. We'll try to link it up later, we'll see. But as of now, we'll stop at ignorance. Now what is its exodus? The exodus of the desire. Desire we have seen upward. Desire in the mind comes from thoughts of the intellect. Thoughts of the intellect come from vasanas. Vasanas come from avidya, ignorance. And from the mind, how does the desire go? It can't stay in the mind, it has to go. So the genesis we have seen, the exodus we have to see. How does it get itself extinguished? Desires are fulfilled not by mere wishing. The file cannot be disposed of by mere wishing, but only by solid action. Technically, therefore, when we act to fulfill a desire, it must get extinct, isn't it? There is a desire in my mind, and I act to fulfill that, it must get extinguished. Unfortunately, it does not happen. That is a tragedy. Before we act and fulfill a desire, another allied thought stems in our intellect, derived from its earlier experience or vasanas, and conveys it to the mind in the form of another desire, prompting the mind to perform another action. So the mind is engaged in a series of actions, series of commands given to the sense organs of perception or the sense organs of action, non-stop. Now these actions are certainly done with a view to fulfill a desire, isn't it? There is a desire behind the action. And these desire-laden actions, egocentric desire-laden actions, by law of karma, they create more and more vasanas, which are again pumped into the intellect as thought, so on and so forth. Desire is an endless stream of waters of Niagara Fall. It keeps on coming. Actions are recycled to vasanas. Where and when can this stop? Or are you happy with this? Then continue. No problem. But if you are not happy, how to stop it? Where it will stop? When it will stop? We have to cut this Gordian knot, the knotty cycle of vicious cycle of vasana, thought, desire, action, vasana, chain. Our great rishis had exhaustively researched on this issue and came to an incontrovertible view, conclusion, that the happiness, happiness is never obtained by fulfilling a desire, because before you fulfill one, another 10 will come up. And so long as there is a desire in the mind, it is a bee in the hornet's nest or a hare in a ripened jackfruit, ever agitated, denying happiness. So by fulfilling a desire, you cannot get happiness because you cannot fulfill that desire. By the time you fulfill that desire, another one in the queue. It's a long queue. Therefore, the scientists, let us say, of subjective life, called rishis, said that the state of happiness is achieved not when a desire is fulfilled, but when an egocentric desire is not entertained. Stop it at the threshold level. Don't convert it into an egocentric desire. Which means achieving a state of desirelessness. Egocentric desirelessness. Now going to the vicious circle once again, a state of desirelessness can come from a state of thoughtlessness, because desire comes from thought. So if you should not have a desire, you should not have a thought. So a state of desirelessness comes from a state of thoughtlessness. Do not misunderstand this word, please. It is not thoughtlessness. It is thoughtlessness. Thoughtlessness, state of thoughtlessness, can come from only a state of vasanalessness. And vasanalessness can come from a state of actionlessness, because your vasanas are created by your actions. So actionlessness means egocentric actionlessness. Not those actions which are free from egocentric desire. Actions which are laden with egocentric desire. The ultimate advice of the rishis therefore is, act wisely, right now and here, to achieve your goal of happiness. A deluded man therefore will be required to take a number of births to fulfill his inexhaustible vasanas and get consequently enmeshed in the welter of samsara. According to the texture of vasanas remaining in our causal body at the time of destruction of the gross body, we get into different kinds of wombs to be born at appropriate places and levels, which are congenial to exhaust those existing vasanas, and the play goes endlessly. Punarabhi jananam, punarabhi maranam, punarabhi janani jadare shayanam, goes the play. On the other hand, the seer or the seeker who had gained the proper and adequate knowledge of the self, no more identifying himself with the body, mind, intellect, equipment, entertaining no egocentric desires, and sublimating all desires in him, and he has known himself to be full and perfect, there is no need for him to feel sad or feel incomplete or feel empty. He is full and perfect. There is nothing that he wants. No emptiness, no imperfection to him. And to him, thereafter, and there is no reason to be in the conveyor belt of birth and death, as he has no unfulfilled desires or undigested thoughts to fulfill. He has no baggage with him. He has no conveyor baggage to be picked up, checked in baggage. He has not checked in anything. He shall therefore experience a state of godhood or a state of nirvana at the appropriate time determined by the cosmic law. Under the Guru's feet, he waits calmly, he waits patiently, fulfilling all his ashrama dharmas, and that at appropriate time on the seat of meditation, he gets that realization, he gets in contact with that electricity, and thereafter the great grand energy flows through him, and then he becomes a second born or a dvija. This is the brief content of this mantra. It's a very beautiful mantra. This can be elaborated hours and hours together, but we have a constraint on time, so we will stop at this here and wait for the next mantra for tomorrow. Hari Om.